Hi, welcome to Earthwatch. I'm David Smith. Well, India is indeed a beautiful and mysterious country. Traditionally, the Indian people have worshipped the animal gods for each day of the week, and there are gods for a whole range of ceremonial occasions and events. These gods take the form of animals like snakes, birds, and of course, monkeys. And so it was fitting that the first place we visited in India was the famous monkey temple near the fabled pink city of Jaipur. And there's Jaipur on the map in north central India.
For the monkeys, you know.
So which is best for the monkeys?
The bananas is the best, right. Followed by the pear, and then these grapes also, the monkeys like to have.
Well, Mr. Smith.
Well, before you have to go to the temple, you have to get some goodies for the monkeys, and the best kind of goodies are bananas and special kinds of peanuts. And that gets us into the fascinating area of bargaining for the fruit. So, how do we do it?
So, how much is this banana?
8 rupees a kg.
No, 5 rupees.
No.
Okay, five, four rupees.
Manja,
no, two for these.
2 rupees, two plus manja.
Big ones?
Yeah.
Okay, how much do they weigh? What are we paying? Two?
Yes, we are paying two.
Okay,
you know.
That's fantastic. It's just a short bus ride from the pink city of Jaipur to one of the strangest temples in the world. But in India, even a short journey is an adventure. The road winds round the hills, the bus drives fast, and the sacred cows don't move. We were lucky to film this story on a Tuesday, because Tuesday is the day the Indians have set aside to worship the monkey god, Hanuman. The monkey, like so many animals in India, is sacred, and so it's appropriate that today we're going to visit the monkey temple. The temple itself is set in a steep-sided valley. It looks as though it's been scooped out from the sides of the rock, and it gives it a feeling of being protected, as though it's in a cradle. At the neck of the valley here, are these huge fortifications that would have sealed off the valley and made it a very secretive and private place. Sash, how old is this temple?
It was in the 13th century. It's about 600 years old.
Mm-hmm. And what's the name of the temple?
The name of the temple is Galta, you know, named after a priest called Galwa, you know, who meditated over here.
There's only one temple here, but there are many other buildings surrounding the temple, and it's in those that the priests would live with their families. And everywhere you look, there are the sacred monkeys. The priesthood here is hereditary, which means that it passes on from father to son and stays in the family for generation after generation. Now, the only income the priests have, and there are only three of them here at the moment, comes from tourists like us. The Indians regard this as a blessed place. This is the main part of the temple, and it's regarded as holy because of that permanent spring of water coming out of the mouth of, you've guessed it, the sacred cow of India. Now that water is regarded as being just as holy as the sacred water of the Ganges. It's said that the spring will never dry up, and indeed the area near the temple is a good deal more fertile than the surrounding desert. My guide and I climbed past the bathing pool to the highest and most sacred pool of all, at the highest point in the temple. No one bathes in this pool, so the water has grown thick and green with algae, but it's regarded as the holiest of waters, and it's here that the priests live and meditate. And as always, the monkeys look on with interest. Of course, the real reason you come here is to see the monkeys. There are just thousands and thousands of monkeys in the hills all around here and right here in the temple itself. There are two main sorts of monkeys. There's the langurs, they're the big black-faced ones, and then these little ones all around here with the red faces are rhesus monkeys. Now, all of these monkeys are in fact part of a group called the Old World monkeys. That's the monkeys of Africa and Asia, including India. And they're rather different to the New World monkeys from South America, because the New World monkeys have got tails that can hook up round branches and they can use them as a kind of fifth hand. These monkeys have got either short tails or stumpy tails, and they can't bend them round branches and use them as a thing to get a grip with. Conservation of monkeys has been a bit of a problem in India because the rhesus monkeys were exported to the United States in particular for use in experiments. The Indian government decided to stop that, and in fact it's now illegal to export monkeys, rhesus monkeys, to the US for any experiments. And in fact the numbers of the monkeys have been increasing ever since. It's really easy to feed them. You just have to bring them in like this, and even just holding up the packet of peanuts, it's amazing. They come leaping out of nowhere and try and grab it out of your hand. In fact, that's why I'm holding these bananas and peanuts close to my chest. There's some more for you. I'll get a banana out and see what happens here. When one of them dies, the others pick up the body and take it away to a kind of burial ground. So you never actually see a dead monkey on the roadside. You see dead dogs and perhaps a dead cow, sometimes vultures down at the cow picking at the bones and so on. But you never actually see a dead monkey because they're taken off for a little burial ceremony. It's a most unusual place, with humans and wildlife living together in such harmony. And the setting is so strangely beautiful. Another delightful page to add to our Indian diary. Well, another of India's animal gods was Ganesh, and little Ganesh was half elephant up on the top half there and half human below. And once a year, the city of Jaipur is host to an earth-shaking event, and people come from far and near to see the world-famous Elephant Festival. We are fortunate indeed to arrive in Jaipur just in time for the festival to begin. After the procession, the first race of the day, the elephant race. I don't know what the odds are, but it's fairly easy to pick the heavy favourite.
And they're racing at Jaipur in the Earthwatch Gold Cup, and the early leader is Barunna's Boy ahead of Grey's Ghost. Third is Peter's Fancy, followed by Harvey's Hope, and bringing up the rear is the youngster from Rajasthan, Robert's Raspberry. And as they pass the post, the winner by half a trunk is Brunner's Boy from Peter's Fancy. Grey's Ghost is third, followed by Harvey's Hope, with Robert's Raspberry last by a tail. The exercise has gone well. How many of
Every event at the festival today is judged, and these are the prizes for the best competitors in each event. They've just finished judging for the best elephant.
The best elephant is the first prize.
Sorry. We're about to play elephant polo, and let me just tell you about some of the things you need to play a game of elephant polo. I guess first up, you need an elephant, and there's one right behind me. Actually, you need eight elephants, four per side. Now, of course, you need a driver, and here's a driver. He's called a mahout in India. You need a trusty pith helmet for safety, like so. You need a very, very long stick, polo stick, like this one, which is enormous to reach the ground from way up there. And of course you need a polo ball. Take one polo ball. Let's go and get into the game.
Elephant polo is a very slow game. So slow, in fact, that we decided to add some excitement to the proceedings. Scores were dead even, no goals each. So I thought I'd show the locals how an Aussie plays elephant polo. It's all very strange from up here. It's so high, and the stick is so long, and the ball appears so small and far away, it's almost impossible to hit.
Jaipur's drawing to a close, and what an amazing day it's been. People are now getting ready, they're going home, having dinner, and then coming back for the evening festivities, which will be quite stupendous as far as we can tell from the preparations in the city. Elephant polo, it's slow, it's clumsy, but it's incredible fun. What an amazing experience it's been. If you ever get the chance to come here and play for yourself, it's well worth the trip.
What a day indeed. And in India, each day brings new treats, new sights and sounds, new smells. The most beautiful building in the world is without doubt the Taj Mahal, built at Agra by Shah Jahan in memory of his beloved wife. While at Agra, we saw and heard other links with the India of long ago. This has to be India. Sitting here in front of this cobra with its neck expanded is a pretty scary experience because it's reputed to be the world's second deadliest snake. I've been led to believe that this snake actually doesn't have any venom left. It's been milked of its venom, so it's safe, but I'm frankly uncertain about all that. It's no wonder that if you see one of these out in the bush here in India, you'd be very frightened to see one rearing up at you like that with the hood expanded and those beady eyes mesmerizing you as you stared it in the face. It's enough to freeze you in your tracks for sure. And apparently they do this to their prey animals. They freeze them in their tracks and the animal just remains rigid and then the snake strikes and catches the prey. One of the animals that isn't afraid of the cobra is this little mongoose out here. There are very few animals, in fact, in India that will tackle one of these snakes, and the mongoose does it very, very successfully. It leaps in very fast. It's got lightning fast reflexes and it jumps in from all different directions, trying to get a grip at the back of the neck behind the hood. When it does that, it takes a really fierce chomp and breaks the neck and kills the snake. But it's a fairly ferocious battle, and this little fellow must have a lot of courage to tackle one of these big snakes out there in the desert. Now, another kind of snake that the snake charmer will have used is one like this. This is much more familiar. We have these pythons in Australia as well. And this little snake waits in ambush, and when something runs by, something that looks like a tasty little meal, he can rip out and take a firm chunk on the back of the neck, or perhaps whatever he can catch, the tail, and his teeth all point backwards inside his mouth so that it acts like a kind of barb and the victim can't get out. So the snake's only got one choice, and that is to swallow it. And for that reason, this kind of snake has jaws that dislocate up here and the jaw gets bigger and bigger, and they can swallow enormous animals as prey. So their dinner can be seen passing. There's a huge lump right down their body as it slowly moves down into their stomach. Now, this snake and this snake wouldn't get on terribly well together, so I'm going to keep them some distance apart. The snake charmer has a flute, and we've heard him play the flute, and it's always thought that the music is lulling the serpent here into a kind of a trance, and he's dancing to the music. And so tourists will come by and form a crowd, and they'll see the snake here dancing to the music. Well, it's not true. Snakes don't have ears, so this snake can't hear the music for a start. What he's actually doing is looking at the flute, watching the tip of the flute with his beady little eyes, and following it backwards and forwards like this. And of course people think he's dancing to the tune. Perhaps the most likely reason for the flute playing is to attract tourists like me who come in along the sidewalk and stop and have a look at the snake and pay the snake charmer some money. Back on the road again, and this time a long drive indeed, but one worth every aching muscle, to Bharatpur, and a splendid day at one of the world's finest bird sanctuaries, and one with a notorious history. The story of one of the world's finest bird sanctuaries really begins with one of India's great fighting clans. And Bharatpur lies in the Indian state of Rajasthan, about a day's drive from the Indian capital of Delhi. In 1826, the British captured the fort at Bharatpur and forced the local Maharaja, or ruler, to give up fighting for good. But he didn't give up his guns. Instead, the local Maharajas and their friends stopped shooting people and started shooting ducks, hundreds of them, sometimes thousands of them, here at Kayaladeo Sanctuary. And here is a remarkable trophy board that shows just how many they were shooting at that time. Let's look here, the Maharaja of Bundi. First shoot, 1,412 ducks. Second shoot, 2,008. Third shoot, 1,531. Fourth shoot for the day, only 724. And then along here, we have the visit of His Majesty, His Excellence, the Viceroy, Lord Linlithgow, visited here and shot in the morning 3,044 and in the afternoon 1,229, making a grand total for one day's duck shooting of 4,273. If you're watching in horror, don't forget that all this happened years ago, when hunting game was the in sport. Those times are long past. The Maharaja of Bharatpur turned his great duck shooting preserve into a great wildlife reserve, and even donated his rest house so that visitors could stay here and enjoy it. Its proper name is Kayaladeo Gana Bird Sanctuary, a natural depression in the land which is fed by water from irrigation channels nearby, so that much of it is usually swampy and perfect for water birds. The open vegetation gives a great view of the birds and of the mammals that live here, like feral cattle and blackbuck. Normally they'd be found on higher ground, but in this unusually dry year, they can roam freely. Now what we have here is one of the best breeding places for water birds in all India. An ornithologist is a person who studies birds, and this is an ornithologist's paradise. Chalo. Chalo. Normally, the monsoon arrives each year with a vengeance and floods much of the park, so people use little boats like this one to get around. This year, things are very different. The monsoon just didn't arrive, and so the whole park is really dry. Normally, that area behind me would be completely covered by water, but as you can see, there's no water at all. So this year, well, it's a rickshaw for us. But in any year, the big attraction is naturally the bird life. Each wet season, the park is normally host to a range of birds that migrate here from distant lands, from Siberia, Japan and Europe. The Saras cranes, which mate for life, are revered in India as symbols of happiness and a lifelong relationship. And they all fly in at 10 in the morning. Most precious of all is the rare Siberian crane. There are only 250 of them left in the world, and up to 45 of them come to Kieledeo each year. 36 even arrived last year, despite the fact that the monsoon didn't show up. The next monsoon is due soon, and then there'll be around 365 species of birds at Bharatpur, and that's about, well, one for each day of the year. Most of the migratory birds have left now, but these Brahmini ducks from Ladakh in northern India are still waiting around, enjoying the warm weather. Of course, the park is not strictly for the birds. There are all sorts of creatures here.
This is a pretty amazing find. When the water level falls down in areas like this and leaves dry, stranded pools, sometimes there are fish like this one called the chanar, which actually can migrate between pools by crossing over through the mud. When it does this, it's got to breathe air because, of course, there's no water on its gills, and it has very, very special gills, the things that it breathes through, which are designed not to collapse. Normally, if a fish comes out of the water, its little tiny gills all collapse together because of the air through them. But these fish have got special gills that can't collapse, and so he can migrate through here, heading along this little stream and trying to find a new pool to swim in.
Well, you never quite know what you're going to find here in this bird sanctuary. There are no tigers here, but here's another huge predator, a python, which has been living in the base of that tree over there, and he's quite warm and quite excited. I'm fairly excited myself. He just had a go at me. Beautiful snake.
The python doesn't dig its own burrow. It makes use of one dug by a porcupine. The porcupine isn't eaten. It's way too prickly for that. It's just, well, encouraged to leave. The python's normally active at night, and it'll eat deer and even small mammals like this squirrel. And here are some familiar faces. The minor birds that we in Australia know so well are native to India. They were brought to Australia as pets by our early settlers.
So here is a truly magnificent park, a far cry from the killing fields of the past. And it's a real tribute to the Indian government that this park is home to so many resident birds.
and also a transit stop for those wonderful migratory species, especially the Siberian crane. Cello, cello.
We missed the Siberian cranes by about 10 days. Those were Sarus cranes you saw. I guess we'll just have to try and get back there again. The main reason for going to India, of course, was to film our special program on Project Tiger. You may remember this hideous tiger knife, and also scenes like these. Well, we certainly saw tigers, and we also saw a great tree that took me back to the world of science fiction.
I once read a science fiction novel about a giant banyan tree that grew out and covered the entire planet of Earth. It simply covered all of the ground, sending out roots and branches and spreading around all the land until all humans had to live in the banyan tree, and it was a terrifying place to live because all the other animals lived in there too. And we've come to India and we've found a giant banyan tree. It's bigger than I imagined and more complex. It's incredibly beautiful, and it's host to all sorts of different animals. Everything from snakes that would come out at night to little tiny squirrels. And then most of all, you see up in the branches, fantastic colonies of monkeys, whole families of monkeys living up there, sharing, eating, living in this extraordinary tree. Fantastic tree. This tree's about 200 years old, and it's so huge you can hardly tell where the main trunk is. It seems to be like a whole city of trees all sprouting from the one trunk here in the middle. This is huge. It goes straight up, I don't know, maybe 30 meters to the top there, and it's full of monkeys. The branches actually come out horizontally, and they drop down these really curious vertical roots that come down to the ground and then take root under the soil. And eventually, if they're there long enough, they can actually take over and become the new tree. And so there's a whole series of potentially new trees sprouting up all around the place, some of them even as big as the central trunk now. What a strange city of a tree it is. It offers a wonderful oasis of shade under the hot sun here, and for this reason the Indians regard the tree as a very special place. It's a symbol of regeneration because of its strange lifestyle and the fact that it just goes on growing, and it's a symbol of fertility for that reason. What an amazing tree.
What a tree indeed, and what a superb time we had in India. It's an Earthwatcher's paradise.